Hello and welcome to Behind the Headlines. This is a pre-recorded programme that will go out on Wednesday the 25th of August 2021. And in this programme, we will be doing something different. We will be looking back at some of the stories and some of the big issues that we've covered and featured on Behind the Headlines over the past year. Reagan, it's great that you can join us again for the programme as we look back to a whole year of doing Behind the Headlines.
Oh, it's been quite a year. It's hard to believe it's gone by. It feels like it's been a very long time, but also it's gone by very, very quickly. And so much has happened in the space of that time. And we've had a US presidential election. We've had a lot of stuff related to the Middle East, Iran, and upheaval going on in relation to that. We've talked about China on multiple occasions, freedom of speech, those sorts of things. It's been a year where things seem to be going at a very, very fast pace. We've dealt with matters of prophecy. We've dealt with some politics stuff. And it's been a privilege to be involved, Simon. Thank you for having me on the show. And thank you to our viewers for your eager interactions. They're always encouraging and helpful.
And what's also been really good about the programme as well is not only our Sky platform where a majority of our business viewers watch, but having a complete new audience on YouTube as well. So if you only watch on YouTube, we really value you and we really appreciate you, particularly if you're fellow Americans that love to make these interesting comments in some of the programmes we do on Behind the Headlines. It's great because it's that British American connection, which means that we can reach new audiences with this programme.
It is. I've enjoyed reading a handful of the comments. People don't always know where I'm from.
They're American. The accent, they think you're American, Australian, or English.
And so I get Australian, and this is true. I get Australian a lot. I had one guy from Europe think I was Scottish. I get Irish a lot. I get Irish a whole lot. Had South African a couple of times. Anyone from those places says, no, we don't understand why anyone would think that. But no, I was born in Arkansas in the United States and I've lived here 18 years, hence the my accent getting lost somewhere in the Atlantic.
It's good though, it's good. I love the comments on YouTube. But I mean, we relaunched this program together. I mean, I was doing it for a few years back in 2014, 2015 here by myself, and it's quite hard work doing a program by yourself, so I really appreciate you being my co-host in this one.
Enjoyed it.
What's been so good about these programs is that it's actually lived up to its name, Behind Headlines, that we've been able to look at major news stories and literally go behind the headlines, but also brings in that prophetic element. And I think with this program in particular, Behind Headlines, why I believe that this is such a special program is because it has that prophetic edge. And because of the times in which we're living in which we're seeing Bible prophecy accelerate at a speed that we've never, ever seen before in our lifetimes, that we know in the past year alone through COVID-19 and the global pandemic, we've seen this push towards globalism. And we've also seen really before our own eyes the infrastructure for the Antichrist being built before us. So we are just watching these incredibly significant prophetic end time events absolutely accelerate.
We're seeing so many signposts to what's to come. We've talked a good deal about that, but sometimes we make the mistake of just living in the moment and being a bit indifferent and apathetic to what's going on, not really having our eyes open and not really being awake. And what's incredible to look at is to actually hone in on the reality that God, though he's outside of our dimension, he's working in our dimension. Though he's outside of time and space, he's working in our time and space. So as we're going through these moments of history, it's all part of this grand plan. This the picture I use is of a tapestry, and you have all of these bits and pieces that are woven together. And even if you look on the back of a tapestry, you are like, whoa, that doesn't make any sense. We just see loads of threads tied. You turn it over, and you see the whole picture. it's plain. So in the moment, we're kind of just looking at one little strand, one little thread, one little bit of things, but then turn it over and the picture is there. And what we're seeing now is, I think, increasing clarification, increasing signposts to what's to come and what's promised in God's word.
Absolutely. So the first program that we aired behind the headlines was on Wednesday, the 2nd of September, where we discussed COVID-19. But we have an extract of one of our programs, and this is us covering the US presidential election, where we knew that so much was at stake, not only for the United States, but also for the entire Western world and the globe as well.
This is from Sheena. She says, I'm a devout Christian. Where's the evidence that Christian liberties are at stake under Biden? I have made the following points. Because someone says that they're a Christian doesn't mean they are. In America, Republicans have a gun in one hand and a Bible in the other. What happened to thou shalt not kill? Trump did not denounce white supremacy at the presidential debate. Racism has thrived in the U.S. and is ungodly, as the race riots have thrived under his leadership. Black people have been murdered. Trump's wife had a phone call publicized the other day using the most appalling profanities. Joe Biden has lost two sons and wife. He's not bitter about this. What about Trump's serial adultery, paying off his first wife for his abuse? She never said anything. Your Biden quote about black kids, Biden came back and cleared up what he meant. He admitted his mistake. In the 1973, Trump was accused of racial bias in the flats he rented. He did not want black people to live in his apartments. Obama asked Hillary Clinton to be a Secretary of State after running again against him. Harris and Biden can change their minds, surely. God doesn't need a hand of man, Republican or Democrat. No man can overturn his plan. I'm anti-abortion, but shouldn't we be teaching our men and women to be in safe, healthy, loving relationships?
To be fair to President Trump, he has changed. And I know people find it very difficult to do that, but look at the fact, what scandal has he been involved in since being president?
Yeah.
I mean, look at the scandals regarding Obama. Look at the big, massive scandals regarding Bill Clinton when he was president. Mm. There hasn't been any scandals.
Exactly. Regarding it's fair to say.
And if you are such a playboy as he was, because he was a Democrat, he did support Hillary Clinton's campaign to become a congresswoman and senator, is the fact that why, as president, would you surround yourself with born-again Christians? Why would you have your vice president as an evangelical Christian, your secretary of state as an evangelical Christian, your also the head of the CIA as well, and your press spokeswoman as a born-again believer? Why then would you allow access to so many evangelicals to come and actually pray in the White House? He's done more to actually, his administration's done more to actually protect Christian religious freedoms throughout the world by putting pressure on governments that persecute Christians. He stood with Israel. He has actually been the first president to stand up and defend the unborn in the United Nations General Assembly. Mm. So I think there is a profound change in his heart since he's become president, but he's a baby believer, right? And he's president, so there's a lot of character issues that God is working through, but there is no doubt that God has used President Trump to push back the entire globalist New World Order agenda. He's done more to protect Christian freedoms and to protect the Bible, and actually his administration's policies are very much focused on biblical principles. So, what a world it feels like now in August 2021 without President Trump. It does feel very strange. I know that when we were looking at this issue, we were looking at what was at stake for the United States, what was at stake for Israel, what was at stake for Britain, because whether you like Trump or whether you don't like him, the fact is that he stood up for Christian values. He defended the unborn. He defended Israel. He defended freedom. He defended democracy. And now he's gone. It feels like the world is just tearing itself apart, all that peace and stability that was in the world. And the world feels an increasingly dangerous place without him.
Yeah, it's very chaotic. It's very unstable. I mean, we talked, I believe, in that program about and that email mentioned some historic critique of Trump, but I'm looking at this past year and I'm seeing what's happened under Biden or what's not happened under Biden, and I'm thinking this is what we have. This is far from impressive. It's not adding anything in a helpful way to the global scene.
Well, no, he's
it's chaos.
Helping to advance the global scene because they're pushing for globalism.
It's total chaos.
Yeah, but I mean, the big question is that, you know, is Biden in control of his faculties? Does he have a sound mind? I mean, you only have to watch one of his press conferences to actually realise the really gentle questioning. It's like a kindergarten or a children's playground in terms of the questions that the media are asking him. And even then, when they ask him questions, he has to have an auto cue, and he messes it up and said some strange stuff.
It might be a hot take, but personally, I think there should probably be a cut off date or some testing that's done before an individual is allowed to run for president. I mean, this is partly why we're in this situation. Just being fully frank, we've had. So many individuals try to vie for the presidency who they really shouldn't have. They shouldn't be in that position where they're allowed to run for office, particularly that office. Here in this country, yes, we have things like, you know, Lord Buckethead or whatever, and that's bizarre. It's a bit of theater, but. You know, the monster-raving loony party is never going to have a prime minister.
Well, they've never been elected. We really don't have to worry about that.
Because there's those things in place. The main parties, they have safeguards.
You're comparing Biden.
I'm not quite. But what I'm saying is that all of these different people who, even back in the 2016 election, who were going in a particular way to try and get elected, you look at it and you think there has to be some safeguarding in order to come up with decent elections and decent election results.
Oh, absolutely. I think we spent the whole program talking about this. I think we need to move on for this one. Yes, we did. That was over a year ago. So the next topic of discussion that we actually discussed, which was extremely interesting, and this was the assassination of the architect of Iran's nuclear weapons program that occurred in December 2020. And what was so significant about this assassination was the audacity of this attack. The fact that these believed to be Israeli operatives deep in the heart of Iran, their regime, taking out their leading scientist and architect of their nuclear weapons program under Iranian territory, then being able to get out and get back. Incredible. I mean, we also saw that we saw attacks on various Iranian nuclear missile sites, as well as other key military infrastructure in Iran, with mysterious explosions coming up, which proved to be extremely successful in denting Iran's nuclear ambitions. But what's so surprising now is now that we have a new president in power in Biden, we haven't heard anything of these sorts. These kind of military operations that Trump allowed are no longer taking place. And instead, what we see is a complete reversal of policy that this US administration is empowering and boosting the Islamic Republic of Iran, to the extent now that the Saudis feel threatened, the Gulf states feel threatened, Jordan feels threatened. And so therefore, they are gravitating to Iran for protection. That is a completely different reversal, complete 100% U-turn on what we had last year.
The Iranian regime, we continue to come back to stories related to that. And of course, Iran has a place in Bible prophecy. If you go back to the ancient kingdom of Persia, that's right there, right in Iran. So it's quite central to what's going on, not just in Bible prophecy, but in current day history as all of these things play out. Here's some discussion related to that. Friday, 27th of November, we saw this event which What may seem distant to some of us is actually quite cataclysmic. For many, the architect of the Iranian nuclear program was assassinated.
And we have a very special guest joining us all the way from the States, who is an Iranian and terrorism expert, none other than Eric Steckelbeck himself. So my big question is, could we see that Iranian retaliation could lead to a war in the Middle East, and this would give Israel and the United States the opportunity to destroy Iran's nuclear program forever, or certainly to destroy the infrastructure of Hezbollah or Hamas, knowing possibly that President Trump only has a few weeks in office in the White House?
Yeah, Simon, that's a possibility. You raise a lot of interesting points. Number one, we had that meeting just last weekend, right, between Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, the U.S. Secretary of State, and Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, and both men met with the Crown Prince of Saudi Arabia, Mohammed bin Salman. And just a few days later, we have Fakhrizadeh meeting his demise. So could this kind of be a situation where Israel and the U.S. says, okay, Iran, they're kind of goading them in a sense, I guess you could say, and to see if Iran retaliates. And you make a good point. If President Trump only has a few weeks left in office, he may be saying that I do not want to leave this Iran nuclear problem to my successor. If that's Joe Biden, look, Joe Biden is a guy who's been very soft on Iran. And Simon, he's talking about re-entering that disastrous Iran nuclear deal.
I go back to this very famous passage in Genesis 12, 1-3, that I will bless those who bless you and I will curse those who curse you. Any nation that curses Israel, that undermines Israel's right to exist, constantly cursing Israel and the Jewish people, God is the avenger of such people.
I think it's important for Christians, as we sort of look at these periods of time where there's trouble, there's wars, there's rumors of war, to recognize that our eyes and our minds and our hearts need to be fully fixed on Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Sometimes it can be unsettling. Sometimes we can lose perspective and lose sight of exactly what's going on. In this case, we have to recognize that even in these details that seem to some degree, perhaps for some, so far removed from our own context, that this is all a part of the plan and purpose that God has for human history. Every single moment has its role. And he's working everything out in that region in such a way that will accomplish his ultimate purposes.
The former head of Israel's security space program, who revealed this week that aliens are actually in contact with both the Israeli and the American government. So we're asking, do aliens exist? Is there life forms on other planets? Or is this part of the end times delusion? And we've got an exciting program tonight. But the interesting thing is we're discussing before this program to actually wear Star Wars costumes. You were going to come as Darth Vader and I was going to come as Yoda.
I was a little gutted, actually, that we pulled the plug on that in the end. But who knows? Maybe we can give the viewers a treat on another occasion in fancy dress.
Absolutely. But I thought this topic was so interesting and so captivating, and I've got my mum to thank for sending me the article in the Daily Mail last week.
Yes, intelligent life exists outside of us, but not those green creatures with the sort of bubble-shaped heads and the massive eyes.
I'm disappointed.
We serve a God who is operating in time and space, but he is outside of time and space.
Absolutely.
He created the universe. So absolutely, I believe in intelligent life outside of Earth. What's more, I believe in a higher spiritual realm that's outside of our own intelligence on Earth. So we have angels, we have demons, and throughout the scriptures, we see accounts, we see records of some interaction between the physical realm and the spiritual realm.
I think it's firstly important to establish theologically the whole concept of alien life forms and extraterrestrials living somewhere on another planet in our universe would make God to be a complete failure. Because we see that none of this is actually mentioned in Scripture. Mm-hmm. Jesus doesn't mention another planet with another life forms. God sent his only begotten son, Yeshua HaMashiach, to die on our behalf so that we could have our sins forgiven and we can have salvation and live with God. So therefore, if God then created another more intelligent life form, then he's already said that everything on this earth is a failure and it doesn't match up to Scripture. But when we actually, when people actually describe their experiences of either alien encounters or being abducted by aliens, the characteristics are very much describe kind of demonic activity. And as you said earlier in Genesis regarding the Nephilim, which is so interesting, isn't it? Because you have these super beings that were actually created before the flood. Called the Nephilim, which very fit that very description of an alien, but they are demonic beings. And this world has been invaded by demonic forces. And so therefore, is it no surprise that as we are so close to the tribulation period and the end times, that this alien conspiracies could actually become the end time biblical deception talked about in 2 Thessalonians 2, I think verse 11. We jumped the gun a little bit there by showing the program we did on aliens instead of Iran. I mean, we can talk about Iran, but when you have a choice about talking about aliens, well, you know, this is where this program is prepared to go. I mean, how many other programs do you know that can actually bring up the discussion on do aliens exist? But let's give a bit of context of why we discussed this. Israel, the head of Israel's former defense and space program, came out and wrote a book out of retirement saying that he believes that aliens exist. And so therefore thought, well, this is a good topic to discuss, particularly in light of the kind of pre-trib rapture and how the aliens could be a very valuable argument for the Antichrist to explain away what's happened when the rapture occurs. And also this kind of mysterious obsession that people have in aliens, helped by the films like Star Wars and so many sci-fi films.
Yeah, you don't have to look very far. You can see, I saw the other evening a film with Rachel kind of about aliens. It was a good film, A Quiet Place Part 2. I recommend it, but one of the things that's weird about it, Simon, is I encounter believers who they are concerned about this. They're concerned that, okay, maybe aliens are real, and as though it affects their view of God, or as though it can impact or challenges a biblical worldview, when it doesn't do that at all. In fact, it simply, the terminology of alien simply shows us that we're living in a world that is happier to believe in the existence of extraterrestrial beings. But when you mention angels, when you mention demons, when you mention God, you believe in Sky Dad or something. I've had people literally insult me, try to offend me, because I
don't believe in aliens.
I believe in Sky Papa or something is how they like to put it. But then it emerges, this individual believes sometimes maybe it could be flat earth, it could be aliens, it could be any number of weird things. There are Christians who obsess even over these elements in such a way that it's a delusion, it's a distraction. And that's what it's all about. It's something that is demonic. Even not just the Israeli individual you mentioned there, who was head of their space force, I believe, in the past. In recent months since then, there have been some articles and some statements made, I believe, out of the Pentagon and a few other places that indicate this belief in extraterrestrial life. I'll say it again, I think I said it on that evening, I believe in extraterrestrial life. I believe, of course I believe in, some people say, do you believe in anything beyond us? Absolutely I do. So you believe in aliens? Well, No, I didn't say that. I believe in God, our creator. I believe in angels, and there are various tiers of angelic beings. We see there's cherubim, there's seraphim, there's the thrones and dominions, powers. Then we have angels who are ministering servants who are active among us, ministering servants on behalf of God's people, and there are demons. And at some point, as we see in the scripture, there's crossover. There's stuff that we experience that we can't even fully explain sometimes.
Absolutely. So let's move on to our next topic if you thought that aliens was bad enough talking about aliens, then we went on to talk about China's development of the super soldier using artificial intelligence together with genetics to create a super soldier, as we discussed how China is also developing what we believe could be, I emphasize could be, the Mark of the Beast infrastructure with its mass surveillance program over its population. Been reading a report about how China is trying to build effectively a new soldier and genetically enhanced soldier to create a super soldier to enhance their military capabilities and to be the most powerful global military on the planet. I know that you've done a recent report on this. Can you share with us some of your findings into what sounds like it's sci-fi or Hollywood, the fact that they want to build these genetically modified soldiers?
Yeah, the conclusion I reached is, sounds like science fiction, that they are trying to breed a master race, which sounds ludicrous, but that's what it is. It's eugenics. There is no bottom to their ethics. They have no ethical concerns. They're trying to breed different animals together. They're trying to breed animals with human intelligence. They want to breed a super soldier that is stronger, doesn't need to eat or drink as much, and then put computer parts in his body. Our country is working on that as well, but Western countries have some ethical considerations. China has none. And so this is a scary prospect going forward. China's bent on world domination, okay, period. And as long as the world pretends that it's not, it's going to move forward toward its goal.
Gordon's G. Chung, author of The Coming Collapse of China, has indicated that China is indeed attempting to create a new master race. This is nothing new. Again, we were talking about Germany in the past. This is exactly along those lines. This is exactly along the lines of what Hitler was seeking to accomplish with the Third Reich. But they're believed to be creating a super soldier using CRISPR gene editing to enhance human performance, very much like what we see in granted, a good positive way, in Captain America. It's the stuff of Planet of the Apes, but it's actually been termed, there's this race on for...
it's a fueled an arms race.
To build a genetically modified being, a human with built-in AI technology. It's essentially along the lines of transhumanism stuff. Homo robocopus. Like, this is sci-fi stuff from, our TV shows and movies that we all thought, oh, yeah, that was an enjoyable film, that was great. This is becoming reality, though.
Yeah, because they want to become the world's most powerful army, and they believe that using genetics and human performance that they can create these superhuman beings. Now, it does sound very familiar to anyone who knows the Bible and know about the Nephilim, because it sounds very, very similar. That you create these super powerful soldiers that are genetically modified, so they got stronger bones, they got a bigger heart, they can run faster, they're stronger, but also connected with AI technology as well. And then they become the ultimate fighting machine. As you can see from those videos of previous programs, the lockdown hasn't been very kind.
It was grim.
It does remind me, I think, it's just of, you know, coming in once a week because of lockdown and not being able to go to the barbers and stuff as well. And, you know, it's just, it's not great for your mental health, is it? It's not great for your kind of mental well-being when you look back at those clips and see the hair, let alone us discussing of kind of RoboCop and Planet of the Apes and Captain America. But, I mean, take that aside, but, I mean, these are really serious developments, and particularly what the Chinese is doing, Chinese are doing in terms of their genetics program, that because they have no sense of morality whatsoever, there are no guidelines. So you can practice what you want. I mean, I think, remember in those programs, they are discussing how the Chinese are developing kind of rats and mice growing human organs, like ears and noses, and then planting like brain DNA into that of into the monkey, so they can think like a human, but also the language gene into apes as well. I mean, that was the whole film. If anyone watched Planet of the Apes, it's exactly what they did on Planet of the Apes. So maybe the Chinese haven't learned anything new. They've just been watching all these big Hollywood blockbusters and say, yeah, let's see if we can do that. But all this is to enhance China's development as a world superpower and to be the world's most dominant power and subdue everyone on the planet.
Simon, some very, very grim facts that we were looking at through there. I even have recently read further on human animal hybrid experimentation.
It's so now we're talking Lon Whitson and Wardrobe, are we?
Well, Mr. Tumnus. Okay, we'll go there. Just grim stuff. Like, it's unreal. And what our friend from CBN was saying as well, like, there's no sense of ethics here.
Yeah, absolutely.
There's no ethics. And that is the result. That is the result. I had this conversation with someone recently. I said, you do realize, because they were telling me where to go, basically, and really making a big deal about being an atheist, though we were at an event where we should have had common ground. So I said, no, okay, you realize that we share this common ground, that we're concerned about where the world is going. We're concerned about what's going on in society. You do realize that this is the product of an atheistic ideology. You can't get away from it. There's no holds barred. There's no such thing as sin. There's no morality. There's no good and bad. There's no real objective truth. So these are crucial areas of identity, of what it means to be made in the image of God. And what China has done and we've talked about this in many programs in this case as well, they're playing God. This is the same spirit evident at the Tower of Babel.
Absolutely.
It's all about trying to show, actually, we are at the top. We're the power.
Also, I think, to bring in the mix, as we did do a program and the discussion title of that program was, Is China Developing the Mark of the Beast? Now, we know, for example, as we did the program, that China is leap years ahead of any other nation in the world in terms of its use of technology and the enhancement of technology. We saw with COVID-19, for example, where they were in the lockdown, they had drones keeping everyone in their houses and keeping them locked up because they were surveilling everything. But the fact, when we look at the Chinese infrastructure, they have 500 million spy cameras that are not only spy cameras, but also motion-equipped cameras. So they can actually recognize you by your walk. So if you're wearing a hoodie, you can't see your face, they will identify you by your walk. We see then that neighbors are encouraged to report on their fellow neighbors if they're not abiding by the laws and the strict regime carried out by China. We also see that China introduced that kind of very dangerous social credit system, whereby the more that you are obedient to the regime and follow the regime, the better rewards you get in terms of better jobs, better housing. If you rebel against the regime, you could have your social credits taken away, so you can't actually go and get onto a train, or you couldn't actually go and have a flight, or worst case scenario, you are given awful jobs and put in very, very poor and bad housing. as a direct consequence in order to control its people. But also we see, for example, how the Chinese have developed electronic ID cards, which store every bit of information on you as an individual that is possible. And of course, they want to sell all this surveillance equipment, all this technology to the West so that they can then impose it on their people. So you can start to see, I think with this program we developed, that this is the nearest thing that we have to a total control of a population, which gives us the clearest indicator that this will likely be the infrastructure or a prototype that will be used by the Antichrist to control the world government and to control the entire world's population, that will force everyone to receive the mark of the beast on their right hand or the forehead. And if they don't, then their heads are cut off and they're murdered. So I think when we're looking at China, we're also seeing that their emergence in Bible prophecies. We did a program recently about the water crisis in I would say a water apocalypse in Iran, and how it talks about how the river Euphrates would dry up to allow the kings from the east to come through. And it talks about an army of over 200 million soldiers. Now, the only nation that's capable of doing that is China.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and one of the things related to China's progression in all of this, and when it comes to Bible prophecy as well, is that we have to bear in mind, Simon, that we are living in history. We are living in a day and time where all of this is working to that fullness of time, to that completeness. Before we get there, we have to go through an actual mark of the beast. I mean, I don't understand, and viewers, maybe there may be someone watching this. We sometimes over-spiritualize Revelation. We sometimes over-spiritualize large chunks of prophecy, and we can't afford to do that in this case. It's very clearly shown throughout the scriptures that there will be a period of intense turmoil, intense tribulation. There's going to be a time in which this lawless one, this one who is the Antichrist, will impose an ideology and belief system on everyone as part also of an economic system. You can't buy, you can't sell. So these are all signposts, at the very least. They're signposts to what's to come.
Absolutely. And we also discussed on Behind the Headlines the rise of lawlessness that Jesus mentioned in Matthew 24. That would be a precursor to his return. So let's have a look at this edition of Behind the Headlines. The unprecedented violence. I mean, burning down 5 miles of the city center in Minneapolis is absolutely horrendous, causing billions of pounds worth of damage to properties, to people's livelihoods. We then saw in the States a big call to defund the police. Mm. And as we look later on the program, that is having dire consequences, that 20 U.S. states have adopted, U.S. cities have adopted this mantra of defunding the police, which we know is not a good idea.
No.
Yeah, there have to be reforms within the police force where rogue police officers behave atrociously and they should be dealt with. But there's no excuse for this mad, senseless violence that we've seen. And we've also seen it last week with Kill the Bill movement in Bristol,
yeah,
where literally police cars have been set on fire. We've seen protesters actually launch fireworks at horses, incredible damage done to property. I think according to our notes here that 20 police officers were injured and 2 seriously, and 7 arrests were made. And they're calling now for a national weekend of action over this Easter bank holiday. And so what we're really seeing, really, I think, in our society is the rise of that lawlessness, because lawlessness expresses itself in attacking those who are in authority. In other words, it's the police that implement the laws and keep the laws, so therefore let's target the police in the most horrific way. And once you start to do that, we start to get anarchy and we start to get lawlessness.
Jeff, we know that according to scriptures, whether it's in Matthew 24 or 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, the Bible talks very clearly about in the last days, one of the key indicators will be a rise of lawlessness. Do you think we are now seeing the lawlessness as mentioned in the Bible?
Simon, I think you're spot on, my friend, because what we're watching unfold is exactly what you said. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 tells us that the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. And sure enough, we are living in a society these days where there is this spiritual vacuum, where the morality of society has broken down. And it's really been replaced with a secularism, which says there is no God. And secularism, because there's no God, leads to really a selfism that says it's all about me, myself, and I. It's about what I want, which then in turn leads to hedonism. And with hedonism, now you have people basically getting rid of the old laws, because the old laws talk about marriage and family and society, you know, laws that held the society together. Well, we got to get rid of that stuff because I want to do whatever I want. And then that creates a breakdown of society. And we're watching that kind of lawlessness starting to abound more and more, preparing the way, as you said, it's a spirit of Antichrist, which is leading us to a place where ultimately there will be the rise of the lawless one.
And I'm sure viewers can well relate to having observed these scenes of lawlessness. It can be quite distressing sometimes to open up the newspapers, to turn on the news, or even you may have been living in one of these areas and you've seen it on your doorstep. This has been something, it's always been there. It's always been around. We see case after case of lawlessness throughout the scriptures. But it does seem in our situation, our society, it's ramping up.
Also, the lockdowns haven't helped. So the national COVID-19 lockdowns have almost created this kind of perfect conditions for kind of lawlessness.
Fever pitch.
Yeah, that people are stuck in their houses. Sometimes people have flats. They're climbing up the walls. They can't get out. They can't do what they normally want to do.
Mental health issues.
And then suddenly something triggers something like we saw with Antifa in the States and BLM. I mean, that was horrendous what happened to, I can't remember his name now, George Floyd. I mean, absolutely hideous. So no way are we defending that at all, because that's just indefensible.
Yeah.
But the reaction to it, actually burning down 2 or 3 miles of Minneapolis
and
city center, £1 billion of damage done. And then what was worse of this one was to say, okay, let's defund the police force. Mm-hmm. So let's not have a police force.
It's self-harming.
So what happens then when that's happened in Seattle and other places in the States? Lawlessness increases.
Yep.
Violence increases. Robberies increases. Murders increase. So, you know, there's got to be a balance with all of this. And then, of course, we saw Kill the Bill, which was a very clever name to kill this policing legislation. But we also saw that those attacks also attacked the police, also known as the Bill. And then, of course, all the extinct rebellions that we saw across London in 2020. 19. I mean, one case that actually blocked the Conservative newspaper's lorries from getting the paper out. So that was a direct attack on freedom of speech. And what we are seeing in this new COVID-19 world is a sense of increasing lawlessness, that people are not willing to abide by laws anymore or by authority. And there's a complete breakdown of trust between the authorities and the public population at large, and that's leading to mistrust, it's leading to violence, it's leading to lawlessness, just as Jesus foretold in Matthew 24.
You know, Simon, there's something that I think we have to identify that is a massive problem, and that's hypocrisy. You can have concerns, and the concerns can be legitimate even in relation to government and its policy and its strategies in this past year. But I remember being at an event in the winter, and there was someone there who was talking about the lawless behavior of the police. He was it wasn't on the platform or anything like that. He was just talking with various individuals, and I was overhearing him. He was talking about how they're lawless to themselves, they're lawless, and all of this. And this is where I began to, I was like, okay, I'm removing myself from this conversation area, vicinity. He said that the only solution he could think of was to line up all the police and execute them. And I thought, okay, so your reaction to what you perceive as lawless is just further lawlessness, anarchy. And that's not what we're supposed to be about. In Romans 13, and 1 Peter as well, we read about submission to authority, and that's not wholesale. That's not something that we say, oh, well, the authority said so, even though I don't think this is right, even though it's not right according to the Bible, I'm going to obey it. Now, of course, there are some laws that being Christians demands that we resist, but not with an anarchist spirit. The word there, submit, in Romans 13 means to put in order under. So even when we disagree, we do so with the spirit of humility. Absolutely. We challenge with a spirit of order and godliness, not hate, anarchy, and anger. That's the anger of man does not produce righteousness of God.
And rebellion. And also we discussed on Behind the Headlines this year, actually, the rise of global governance and how organizations like the United Nations, together with the World Economic Forum, we also heard it from our own Prime Minister, and also President Biden, the whole concept of global governance, which is another term for world government.
This big change that they're speaking of doesn't sound all that great to us. I think we're saying that, well, yes, it's inevitable that God is in all of this. We need to be aware that this is, as you said, what exactly is happening. The Bible prophecy being fulfilled, seeing one world governance and increased control, and we can eagerly be excited for the return of Christ out of all that. At the same time, there are basic structures of righteousness and truth that we shouldn't just cast off and say, oh, we don't care because this just means Jesus is coming soon. No, we have to care, and we have to continue pursuing what is righteous and good for God's glory. We have, this is a really good, really good comment, I think, from John. He says, I think a lot of believers are waiting for this great revival and then the rapture. Even then, they just want to be spectators, not participants in soul winning. Time to get on with the job on a personal basis. Time to get a backbone and stand up for his righteousness to enter society. So, you know, it's not just something that viewers, we shouldn't be wringing our hands over it on our sofas at home and just praying for revival. Prayer is key, but remember, God has given us a means through which to convey the truth of Jesus Christ to society. That's proclamation of the truth. That's engaging on these issues and declaring to a world that's wondering what's happening, a world that's in chaos, that there is hope in a world of hopelessness and helplessness, and that hope is Jesus Christ. Thank you, John. That's wonderful.
Amen. So, yesterday evening, I interviewed Dale Hurd, not only on the global reset, but also on the moves towards global governance. So this is Dale Hurd on Behind the Headlines.
Dale, you do fantastic news reports. And one of the reports that you've done over the past year during the COVID-19 lockdown, essentially, was the news that the World Economic Forum called for a global reset, or the fourth industrial revolution. Can you just explain to us the agenda that the globalists are exploiting through this COVID-19 crisis?
Well, I would sum it up as a rule by expert, and I would use a couple of other analogies. First of all, they think that experts know best, you don't. They're tired of nationalism, they're tired of interference from troublemakers, like if we go back in history, Margaret Thatcher, or today Viktor Orban or Donald Trump. They want to make sure that stops happening, because they have this brilliant plan for your future, because they're so smart. And the other analogy I would use is sort of a post-World War II landscape that, you know, we saw, okay, so the Europe is broken. Let's rebuild a post-war order that's more peaceful and productive. And in that case, it was good. So they see what we're going through now with nations prostrate from this COVID lockdown as their chance, you know, let's do a redo. Let's, as they put it, build back better.
And one thing that we have wanted to do regarding Behind the Headlines is to provide that cutting edge analysis of world events, particularly as they relate to Bible prophecy. And I remember a couple of years ago, all of the stuff that we've been discussing over the past year, Reagan, in terms of Bible prophecy, was pretty much in the dark. It was in the shadows. You could almost describe it as being in the realms of conspiracy theory. But since 2020 and COVID-19, these have come out to the fore. I mean, you've had the World Economic Forum calling for a global reset and world government. We've also seen, for example, how the UN have called for global governance, yeah, which is another term for world government. We've seen China develop the first digital economy and Britain now to follow suit. Of course, then we also discussed the kind of vaccine passport and how they want to use the vaccine travel passport as a pretext in order to bring in a global citizen ID so that we can move closer and closer into kind of globalism. And it seems that, you know, the world has learned nothing. And we're seeing, again, our world and our leaders pushing for the Tower of Babel. And we're heading in that direction, using English as the world language in order to unite the world on this false hope that humanity can get to God by his own means. And we know that what happened with the Tower of Babel when God divided them all, gave them all separate languages and cultures, so they couldn't unite again. So we are again at that place in world history where our leaders think that this is the best thing for us, is to be controlled by a handful of people, and the entire population is then controlled, and of course using this brand new technology, digital technology, AI technology, in order to bring it about.
Yeah, definitely. There's so much hubris, there's so much pride, there's so much arrogance in how this is presented. And what we have to, as Christians, remember is the solution to these things is it's never of the kingdoms of this world. The kingdoms of this world can't come up with the solution. Politics, ultimately, while they're means to an end, and we should involve ourselves in good conscience and as much as we can in seeking to change that for God's glory, at the same time, it's not politics that will change it. This is a spiritual war fundamentally that we're involved in, that we're seeing played out in very real life moments. So the reminder in Ephesians 6 is to be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might, to put on the full armor of God, and having done all, to stand firm.
Ephesians 6.
That's
one of my favorites. And that's what we do need to do in these last days is, as Christians, we need to educate ourselves. Mm. We need to spend time in the Word, but we also need to be watchmen on the walls of Jerusalem. We need to be able to discern the times in which we're living in. And, you know, when it comes to Bible prophecy, the acceleration over the past year or something else is extraordinary. And I think this is why this program is here, really, to be that watchman on the wall so that we know what is happening, so that we are not in the dark, we are not deceived, and that we are prepared for the days that lie ahead.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's hopefully is what we have another year to come. Hopefully next year we'll look back and we'll say, look at what God has done as well, and maybe seeing revival and maybe seeing awakening, and hopefully seeing some positive changes as well. At the same time, even with all of the negative stuff that's going on, we can look at it in a positive way. We can look at it and say, look, all of this is being worked. God is working in and through it all. It's all leading to the return of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, there's a lot before he comes again. But when he comes again, there's perfect peace. And we look forward to that day when every tear will be wiped away and we'll have one king who is good, who is righteous, who is
just. Absolutely. And I think we are, as we come to the end of this review of the past year, of all the programs we've done on Behind Headlines, I think one thing becomes very clear is that, you know, we have to look up because our redemption draws near. And we are rapidly, rapidly moving towards the book of Revelation. We are rapidly moving towards the tribulation period. We are seeing the chess pieces put in place. And I don't think that, honestly, there is that much more that needs to be fulfilled prophetically before Jesus returns. I mean, personally, I believe that the rapture is very imminent. You know, it could come tomorrow, it could come in a week's time, a month's time, a year's time, a decade's time. We don't know. But what we have to do is that we have to discern the scriptures. We have to discern the book of Revelation. We have to discern what is happening in our world and not be consumed about ourselves, but to look out for the needs and the help of others and use these end time events we're seeing as a rallying call and an opportunity to share the gospel, right?
Absolutely. And as we present the gospel, to do so with that hope, recognizing that it's not that God has delayed the coming again of Jesus. It's that he's patient and wants all people to repent.
Well, it's been a fantastic year. I look forward to a new year of programs with you, Reagan, God willing. And we want to thank you so much for your support. Thank you for watching Behind the Headlines. And we promise you some exciting programs to come in the autumn as we unpack the news stories that have a prophetic impact on our world. So keep faithful, keep watching, and stay tuned for Behind the Headlines.